Hey friends, in this lecture we are going to discuss about cataract. Be attentive while listening this lecture because this lecture is going to be very lengthy. But important point is that this lecture is very important for your PG preparation as well as for your university examinations. And if you search, such type of video is not available in any YouTube channels. So I decided to make a video which describes all the important details of cataract in a single video. So in this lecture, before going to start actual cataract, first we are going to discuss about what is the anatomy and physiology of the lens. Then we are going to discuss about classification of the cataract. After the classification, we are going to describe about the important cataracts like senile cataract, congenital cataract, complicated cataract and traumatic cataract. After that, we are going to discuss about what is the treatment of cataract, that is about the cataract surgery. And after that, we are going to discuss about what are the complications of the cataract surgery. We are going to cover all the important points for your PG preparation like applied anatomy, physiology and biochemistry. And this is very important because before going to start cataract, we must know the anatomy of the lens. So here we go. From the gross anatomy of lens, we must know these 10 points. The first one is the lens is made up of surface ectoderm and the shape of the lens is biconvex. The color of a lens is transparent because there is no blood supply to the lens, that is, it is avascular in nature. There is no nerve supply. The refractive index of a lens is in between 1.386 to 1.406, and the maximum refractive index is present on a center of a lens. So what is the site of a lens? Where it is present? The site of a lens is in patellar fossa and the equatorial diameter is nearly 10 mm. And the last point is, what is the power of a lens? It is nearly plus 16 to plus 19 diopter. What are the attachments of a lens? At the periphery, it is attached to ciliary body by zonules obgyns, and at the posteriorly, it is attached to retroanterior ligament. So what are the structures of a lens? The lens is consist of lens capsule, lens epithelium and lens fibers. The lens capsule is a thin, transparent hyaline membrane. It is thickest at pre-equatorial regions and the thinnest at posterior pole. Lens epithelium. Lens epithelium, it is a single layer of cuboidal cells, and in equatorial region, this cell becomes columnar, and at the posterior region, there is an absence of epithelium. And the third one is lens fibers. Lens fibers make up the most of a lens volume and are laid horizontally and concentrically like layers of an onion. Look at this. Yes, it is looks like onion peels. So these lens fibers arranged compactly as nucleus and cortex. So first we are going to study about nucleus. Nucleus consists of different zones, and at the central part there are oldest fibers are present. So depending upon the period of development, the different zones of the lens nucleus includes embryonic nucleus, fetal nucleus, infantile nucleus and adult nucleus. So embryonic nucleus, it is the innermost part of a nucleus. It consists of primary lens fibers. The fetal nucleus, it is lie around the embryonic nucleus. Its fibers meet around the sutures, which are anteriorly Y-shaped and posteriorly inverted Y-shaped. Look at this diagram. And the third one is infantile nucleus. It is surrounds the fetal nucleus and it corresponds to the lens from birth to puberty. And the last one is adult nucleus. The adult nucleus is correspond to puberty to the rest of life, and it is surround the infantile nucleus. The second one is cortex. Cortex present at the peripheral part of a nucleus, and it consists of youngest lens fibers. And here we have a simple question, that is, in which part there are youngest cell fibers are present? And the options are embryonic, fetal, infantile, or adult nucleus. What is your guess, or what do you think? Yes, at the center part, there are the oldest fibers are present, that is, in embryonic period, there are the primary lens fibers are present in central part. So, the youngest fibers are present at which part? Yes, absolutely right. It is present on adult part. And suppose if you have option of cortex, then must write cortex. So, what are the applied physiology and biochemistry behind the lens? Lens, being an avascular structure, is depend for its metabolism on chemical exchanges. So, what are the sources of chemical exchanges? The 90% of the nutrients are get from aqueous humor, and the 10% is from vitreous humor. Glucose is very essential for the normal working of a lens. Then, the glucose is rapidly metabolized through four pathways. The first one is anaerobic glycolysis, or we can say glycolytic pathway, in which 80% of your glucose is metabolized. Second one is HMP shunt pathway, and in which nearly 50% of your glucose may be metabolized. The third one is Krebs citric acid cycle, and the fourth one is sorbitol pathway. In sorbitol pathway, glucose is metabolized by aldose reductase to sorbitol. The major problem with sorbitol pathway is that sorbitol cannot diffuse out of a lens, and because of that, there is gradually increasing osmotic pressure. And due to increasing osmotic pressure, the fluid from outside start flowing inside, and therefore there may be complications of opaque or haziness of a lens. And finally, it will end with cataract. The sorbitol pathway is mainly active in diseases like diabetes mellitus or in galactosemia. So this is all about lens, and in which we cover its applied anatomy, its structures, and applied physiology and biochemistry. So first, we are going to start with congenital cataract. So in which we will discuss about its etiology, how the congenital and developmental cataract occur, what is the reason behind it, and after that we will discuss clinical types, right? And at last we will cover the points which are important for your PG preparation. Now moving toward first, that is etiology. So this is crystalline lens, and here we have embryonic nucleus. Fibers covering the embryonic nucleus are fetal nucleus, thereafter infantile nucleus, there is a adult nucleus, and at last this is cortex. So these are the different parts of nucleus, right? Now what happens due to some disturbances in the normal growth of the lens? When the disturbances occur before the birth, this is called as congenital cataract, right? So congenital cataract, it limited to only either embryonic or fetal nucleus, that is the development of embryonic and fetal nucleus. And the developmental cataract may occur from the infantile and adult nucleus. So due to disturbance of infantile and adult nucleus, which form the developmental cataract. So this is congenital and this is developmental. Now what is the actual etiology behind the formation of or the disturbance of the normal growth of the lens? So etiology is 33% it is idiopathic, it can be hereditary, maternal factors, or fetal factors. In hereditary, major cause are chromosomal disorders, like it is occur in trisomy 21. It can be occur due to Strickler syndrome or due to Lewis syndrome. And in maternal factors, there can be malnutrition during pregnancy, or there may be infection during pregnancy, the infections like rubella generally associated with congenital cataract, or it can be due to toxoplasmosis. By the drug ingestion, the drug like corticosteroid can cause the developmental or congenital cataract, and it can be due to the radiation. We have the simple mnemonic in which we can easily remember what are the maternal factors, that is DREAM. D for drug ingestion, R for radiation, I for infections, and M for malnutrition. Moving towards the fetal factors in which oxygen deficiency, that is anoxia, there may be birth trauma or the metabolic disorders like galactosemia or galactokinase deficiency, or it can be due to the neonatal hypoglycemia. Malnutrition in early infancy may also cause developmental cataract associated with other congenital disorders that we discussed earlier, that is trisomy 21 Stickler syndrome, or it can be due to Loewy syndrome or Down syndrome. Now moving toward next topic, that is clinical types. In congenital cataract, there is congenital capsular cataract, there can be polar cataract, congenital nuclear cataract, or there can be generalized cataract. There are subtypes. In congenital capsular cataract, there can be anterior capsular cataract, or there may be posterior capsular cataract. In polar cataract, same, there are two poles, so in which there may be anterior polar cataract or there can be posterior polar cataract. And in congenital nuclear cataract, there may be cataracta pulverinta, lamellar cataract, total congenital cataract, or sutural and axial cataract. We can remember congenital nuclear cataract as TLCS, that is total leukocyte counts. T for total nuclear cataract, L for lamellar cataract, C for cataracta pulverinta, and S for sutural and axial cataract. And in sutural and axial cataract, there is also subtypes, that is floriform, coralliform, or spear-shaped cataract. And at last, in generalized cataract, there can be coronary cataract, there may be blue dot cataract, there can be total congenital cataract, and at last congenital membranous cataract. So this is the clinical types of congenital and developmental cataract, right? Now we will cover only those important point which is very important for your examination point of view. So the first, that is zonular cataract, or it is also called as lamellar cataract. It is refers to the developmental cataract in which the opacity occupies the discrete zone in the lens. Look over here. Here the cataract occurs in specific zone, right? That's why it is called as zonular cataract. And this is looks like the spoke, that is there is a small linear opacities like spokes of wheel can be seen, and it is most common type of congenital cataract presenting with visual impairment. Okay, then second one is posterior polar cataract, and it is also very common lens anomaly that is consist of opacities involving the posterior pole. Look over here. Here is the appearance like onion holes. So the appearance is onion holes appearance, and it is generally associated with Mittendorf dots. Remember that it is generally associated with Mittendorf dots. What is Mittendorf dots? It is a persistent hyaloid artery remnants. Next one, that is blue dot cataract. It is also called as punctate cataract, and it is most common congenital cataract in the children's. Look over here. There is a characteristic punctate opacities are formed, and rounded bluish dot situated in peripheral parts of the adolescent nucleus. So the opacities are usually stationary and do not affect the vision. So there is a no loss of vision, and it is generally associated with Down syndrome. Next, that is coralliform cataract. What is coral? Coral, it is found in oceans. And look over here. Here we have the structure which is giving an appearance resembling the coral, right? And that's why it is called as coralliform cataract. And there is no profound loss of vision. The next, we must know about congenital rubella cataract. And it is occur generally in triad. There is a salt and paper radiotherapy that is the most common ophthalmic finding in congenital rubella cataract, or there may be glaucoma, or there is a nucleus cataract. So this is the triad of congenital rubella cataract. Remember it. So this is all important points from congenital and developmental cataract, in which we cover what is congenital cataract, that is the disturbance in the normal growth of the lens. In congenital cataract, it is occur in embryonic or fetal nucleus, or in developmental cataract, it can be occur in infant or in adult nucleus, right? Then we discuss about the etiology, in which we cover idiopathic cause, that is 33%. Then there may be hereditary cause, there may be maternal cause, or it can be due to fetal or infantile cause, right? And after that, we discuss about its clinical types, right? In which we discuss the four main types, that is congenital capsular cataract, polar cataract, congenital nuclear cataract, and generalized cataract. And after that, we discuss about only important cataract that can be asked in your exams, in which we cover jonular cataract, in which there is a spoke-like pattern. Due to the spoke-like pattern, it is also called as Rider's cataract. Then we discuss about posterior polar cataract, and after that we discuss about blue dot cataract, in which there is no loss of vision. Then we discuss about coralliform cataract, there is also not profound loss of vision, and after that we cover triad of congenital rubella cataract. Now we are going to start with senile cataract. Age related cataract, it is acquired type of cataract, and it is also called as senile cataract. Senile, the name is itself indicating that it is an old age disease. What is cataract? Cataract, it is development of any opacity in lens or in its capsule. So this senile cataract, it is commonest type of acquired cataract, in which usually one eye is affected earlier and it is followed by the other eye. So what are the morphological types of senile cataract? There are three morphological types of senile cataract. The first one is cortical senile cataract, which is soft in nature. Then second one is nuclear cataract, which is hard in nature. And the third one is mixed cortical and nuclear cataract. So these are the morphological types of senile cataract. Now in cortical senile cataract, we have two different types of senile cataract, that is cuneiform cataract and cupuliform cataract. Cuneiform, it is most common type of cataract, which is occur in 70%, while the cupuliform, it is posterior subscapular cataract, because it is occur in posterior subscapsule of the lens. Now moving toward the etiology of senile cataract. Senile cataract, it is essentially an aging process, and the risk factors are, first one is age. It is the most important risk factor, because senile, the name is itself indicating that it is an old age disease. It is occur mainly after 50 years. If the cataract occur before 45 years, then it is called as presenile cataract. Now, sex, without any doubt, the senile cataract affects both male and female. But the prevalence of this cataract, it is greater in female. Hereditary plays considerable role in the incidence of cataract. Ultraviolet radiations. More exposure to ultraviolet radiation from sunlight have been implicated for early onset and maturation of senile cataract. Dietary factors. Deficiency of vitamin A, C and E. We can remember it as ASH, and deficiency of proteins and amino acids are implicated for early onset and maturation of senile cataract. Dehydration crisis. Like in diarrhea, cholera, it is associated with age of onset and maturation of senile cataract. Smoking. Smoking causes accumulation of pigmented molecules and cyanides, leading to protein denaturation. The smoking causes accumulation of pigments like 3-hydroxycyanurin and chromophores, which leads to yellowing of lens. Now, what is the pathology? So this is cortical senile cataract, and the pathology behind this cortical cataract is there is a decreased level of total proteins, amino acids, potassium, and increase the concentration of sodium. That's why there is a marked hydration of lens, and due to the marked hydration of lens, there is a coagulation of proteins, and this is the pathology behind cortical senile cataract, which contain cuneiform cataract and cupuliform cataract. The other one is the nuclear cataract, and in nuclear cataract there is a degenerative conditions occurring due to nuclear sclerosis. That's why there is an increase in water soluble proteins, and due to this there is a compaction of nucleus and there is a formation of hard cataract, that is the nuclear cataract. So it is the pathology behind nuclear cataract and the cortical cataract. In cortical cataract there is a marked hydration of lens and from coagulation of proteins, and here is a compaction of the lens and cause hard cataract. Now, stages of maturation of both cortical and nuclear cataract. So first we are going to discuss the maturation of cortical cataract. So there are different stages of maturation. First stage is stage of lamellar separation. Look at the diagram. This is nucleus, this is cortex, and this is capsule. So in this stage there is a formation of vacuoles and water clefts in anterior and posterior cortex. This is the cortex, and there is a formation of vacuoles and water cleft. This leads to demarcation of cortical fibers owing their own separation by fluids. This phenomenon of lamellar separation can be demonstrated by slit lab examination only. The second stage is stage of incipient cataract. In incipient cataract, at this stage, there are two types of cortical cataract can be seen. The first one is cuneiform senile cataract, and the second one is cupuliform senile cataract. In cuneiform senile cataract, it is characterized by wedge-shaped opacities with clear areas in between, seen first in lower nasal quadrant. There are four quadrant of eye, that is the lower nasal quadrant, upper nasal quadrant, upper temporal quadrant and lower temporal quadrant. So it is first observed in lower nasal quadrant. On oblique illumination, it is looks like radial spoke pattern. Look at this diagram. It is looks like radial spoke pattern. Now the second one, that is cupuliform senile cataract, it is saucer shaped opacities in central part of posterior cortex. That's why it is also called as posterior subscapsular cataract. This cataract lies in visual axis, and that's why there is a early loss of vision, because it is lies in visual axis. So this is stage of incipient cataract. Now the third stage, that is immature senile cataract. In immature senile cataract, The opacity progresses further and the lens become grayish white, but clear cortex still present, and that's why iris shadow can be seen. At this stage, lens may swell on due to continued hydration because it is progressive opacification. So there may be chances of swollen due to continued hydration, and if this occur, it is called as intumescent cataract, swallowing of lens due to continued hydration. Look at the diagram. This is immature senile cataract. Now the fourth stage is mature senile cataract. In mature senile cataract, look at this diagram. The opacification becomes complete, that is, whole of the cortex is involved. So opacity is complete. And look at this lens. Lens is pearly white in color. That's why it is called as ripe cataract, because in which the opacity is complete. So what will you think, that there is shadow or not? Yes, there is a absence of visual shadow. And the fifth one is hypermature senile cataract. In hypermature senile cataract, it may occur in two forms. The first one is Morganian hypermature cataract, and the second one is sclerotic type of hypermature cataract. In Morganian hypermature cataract, look at this diagram, in which the whole cortex is liquefies and it is looks like a bag of milky fluid. Yes, so the cortex liquefies lens and it is looks like bag of milky fluid. The nucleus settle at the bottom. Nucleus is settled at the bottom, and there may be calcium deposits may also seen on lens capsule. Okay. The other one is sclerotic type of hypermature cataracts, in which the cortex is disintegrated and lens become shrunken due to leakage of water. Anterior chamber may become deep, and due to this there is a tremulous iris. In this type of cataract, there is a thickening of anterior capsule due to proliferation of anterior cells. Anterior capsule become thickened due to proliferation of anterior cells. So this is about the hypermature senile cataract. Two types of hypermature senile cataract, that is Morganian cataract and sclerotic type of hypermature cataract. Now moving towards its clinical features. In clinical features, the first one is glare. This is the normal image, and this is image seen by the cataractous person. There is a color hollows around the light. Look over here. There may be black spots in front of eyes like this, and there may be blur and misty vision like this. This all occurs in senile cataract. So clinical features are glare, uniocular diplopia or polypia, colored halos around light, look over here, poor color discrimination, black spots in front of eyes, look over here, blur and misty vision, and deterioration of vision. So these are the clinical features of senile cataract. And remember that colored halos are more common in nuclear cataract. Now, what are the signs of senile cataract? The first, that is the visual acuity, it is in between 6/9 to perception of light present. If we test for iris shadow, if iris shadow is present, then there is a immature cataract. When lens is completely transparent or opaque, no iris shadow is formed. Hence, if the presence of iris shadow is seen, then it is a immature cataract. That is, it is a sign for immature senile cataract. Color of lens. So we'll discuss the stages of cataract. So in which nuclear cataract, immature senile cataract, mature senile cataract, Morganian hypermature senile cataract, and sclerotic hypermature senile cataract. So what are the color of lenses in all these types of cataract? So in nuclear cataract, there is amber, brown, black or reddish color of lens. In immature senile cataract, there is a grayish white color of lens. In mature senile cataract, there is a pearly white color of lens. In Morganian hypermature senile cataract, there is a milky white appearance of lens. In sclerotic hypermature senile cataract, there is a dirty white color of lens. So this is the color of lens in different types of cataract. Now, what are the complications of senile cataract? So there are three complications of senile cataract, that is phacoanaphylactic uveitis, lens induced glaucoma, subluxation or dislocation of lens. So in which in lens induced glaucoma, there is a three types of glaucomas can be formed because of complications of senile cataract. The first one is phacomorphic glaucoma, second one is phacolytic glaucoma, and the third one is phacotopic glaucoma. So phacomorphic glaucoma, it is most common type of lens induced glaucoma. It is most common type of lens induced glaucoma by intumescent lens. Remember that intumescent cataract, it is found in the stage of immature senile cataract and it is occur due to the continuous hydration to the lens. The second one, that is phacolytic glaucoma, it is occur by Morganian type of hypermature cataract and it form secondary open angle glaucoma because in this the lens proteins are leaked into anterior chamber and due to which there is a the swollen macrophages clog the trabecular meshwork leading to increase in intraocular pressure and that's why there is a formation of secondary open angle glaucoma. And the third one is phacotopic glaucoma. It is occur by hypermature cataractous lens. So these are the complications, that is phacoanaphylactic uveitis, lens induced glaucoma and subluxation or dislocation of lens. So what we learn till now? First we discuss about what is cataract, what is senile cataract, then after that we take a look on morphological types of senile cataract, that is cortical senile cataract, nuclear cataract and mixed cortical and nuclear cataract. Then we discuss the etiology of the cataract, in which we look on age, sex, heredity, UV radiations, dietary factors, hydrational crisis and smoking. These are the etiologies behind the formation of senile cataract. Then we take a look on pathology behind the formation of senile cataract, in which we take the look on formation of cortical senile cataract and then we learn about formation of nuclear cataract. After that we discuss about the stages of maturation of cortical cataract, in which we discuss the stage of lamellar separation, stage of incipient cataract, stage of immature senile cataract and stage of mature senile cataract, and after that the stages of hypermature senile cataract, in which there are two types of hypermature senile cataract, Morganian hypermature cataract and sclerotic type of hypermature cataract. After that we discuss about clinical features, that is the glare, uniocular diplopia or polypia, colored halos around light, poor color discrimination, black spots in front of eyes, blur and mystery vision and deterioration of the vision. And after that we take a look on signs and the color of lens, and at last we discuss about the complications, that is phacoanaphylactic uveitis, lens induced glaucomas and subluxation or dislocation of lens. So this is all about the senile cataract. It is a very important topic as far as your NEET and for your UG preparation. We are going to start with complicated cataract. What is complicated cataract? Complicated cataract, it is a opacification of the lens secondary to some other intraocular disease, like inflammatory or degenerative diseases of the other part of the eye. That's why it is called as secondary cataract. So this is the clear lens and this is opacification of the lens. Now we know that lens depends on its nutrition on intraocular fluids like aqueous humor, vitreous humor. So if there is a disturbance of the nutrition of the lens due to inflammatory or degenerative diseases of the other part of the eye, such as iridocyclitis, ciliary body tumors, or myopia, or anterior segment ischemia, then it may cause the secondary cataract, that is complicated cataract. Now, moving toward its etiology, I already told that it is based on the nutrition of the lens. So, if there is a disturbance for the nutrition of the lens, it may rise to complicated cataract. The conditions from which the complicated cataract may rise are inflammatory conditions, degenerative conditions, retinal detachment, glaucoma, or intraocular tumors. Inflammatory conditions like uveal inflammation, hypopia and corneal ulcer, endophthalmitis, and anterior uveitis. So in which anterior uveitis, it is most common cause. Remember that it may be asked in your exams. The second one, that is degenerative conditions like retinitis pigmentosa and myopic chorioretinal degenerations can cause secondary cataract. Long-standing cases of retinal detachment may cause complicated cataract. In glaucoma, primary and secondary glaucoma impair the intraocular circulation due to rise in intraocular pressure. And due to this impaired intraocular circulations, there is a improper nutrition to the lens. And that's why there is a formation of secondary cataract. And the last one, that is intraocular tumors. In intraocular tumors, there is a retinoblastoma and melanoma can cause complicated cataract. Now moving toward its clinical feature. So complicated cataract typically start from posterior subscapsular cortical cataract. And in beam of slit lamp, the opacity looks like breadcrumb appearance. This is the breadcrumbs and the opacities are appear like the same. Then there is a polychromatic luster. Poly means multiple and chromatic means color. So there is a multiple color like red, green, blue. It's vary from its characteristic from the particles. And that's why it is called as rainbow cataract. There is a diffuse yellow haze and later on the lens become opaque. The color of the lens is changed to dirty white or chalky white appearance. And later on there is a deposition of calcium. So these are the clinical features of the complicated cataract, that is breadcrumb appearance, polychromatic luster, diffuse yellow haze, and later on the lens become opaque and deposition of calcium. Now we are going to start with traumatic cataract. Traumatic cataract, it is also called as concussion cataract. It is caused by mechanical injury and physical forces. So what is the etiology behind the formation of traumatic cataract? It may be caused due to the blunt trauma, maybe by penetrating trauma, or by electrical shock, or infrared radiation or ionizing radiation. So these are the causes which leads to the formation of traumatic cataract. Now we will going to discuss about what are the pathological changes occurs in the lens which rise to cause the traumatic cataract. So the pathological changes, it occurs partially due to the mechanical effects of the injury on the lens fibers. There is an injury on the lens fiber and largely due to the entrance of aqueous due to damage to the capsule. There is a damaged capsule. So there is impaired entrance of the aqueous flow because lens depend upon aqueous humor for its nutrition. So These changes may cause the traumatic cataract. Okay, so this is pathology behind the traumatic cataract. Now, we will discuss in short what are the effects of blunt trauma on the lens. So, there is a formation of osseous ring, minute anterior subscapsular opacities, concussion cataract, that is traumatic cataract, early rosette cataract, late rosette cataract, subluxation of the lens and dislocation of the lens. Remember that it is the effects of blunt trauma on the lens. Now, before moving towards the clinical feature, remember this point, that is osseous ring. It is a circular ring of brown pigment seen on anterior capsule. So why it is occur? It is occur due to striking of the contracted pupillary margins against a crystalline lens. Remember that it is occur due to striking of the contracted pupillary margins. This is the pupillary margins, and due to their striking, it causes the osseous ring, and it is always smaller than size of pupil. Okay, so what is the sequence? There is a pressure on eyeball due to the trauma, yes, and after that, due to this pressure, it drives cornea and iris backward, yes, and due to this, there is an impression of iris on lens, and due to the striking on the lens, this causes osseous ring. Okay, now moving toward its clinical features. So first, there is a discrete subepithelial opacities. Then there is a early rosette cataract. What is early rosette cataract? There is a star-shaped suture lines. Look at this image. Here we have the star-shaped suture lines. This is the important sign for the detection of early rosette cataract, in which the posterior cortex is involved and it is occur few hour or months after the injury. Then there is an accumulation of fluid along with the sutural arrangement of the lens fiber. And this is the most typical form of concussion cataract. Yeah. Now, the other one is late rosette cataract. So what happened in late rosette cataract is, it is occur 1 or 2 years after the trauma. Posterior cortex is involved and small, compact with short sutural extensions. Look over here. Here we have the image of the late rosette cataract, and there is a small, compact and the short sutural extensions. And it may cause traumatic jaundular cataract, can cause diffuse concussion cataract, or it may cause early maturation of senile cataract following the blunt trauma. So this is all important details about the cataract. Now we are going to move toward its treatment part. So we are going to start with management of cataract. This can be a separate question in your university examination. In previous lectures, we are discussed about senile cataract, congenital cataract, complicated cataract, traumatic cataract, and many more. And in this lecture, we are specially going to focus on treatment of the cataract, or we can say the management of the cataract. Before going to start this lecture, it's my personal request to watch all previous videos on cataract. Okay, so for management of cataracts in adults, we have two measures. The first one is non-surgical measures, while the another one is surgical measure. In non-surgical measures, we can delay the progression or might stop the progression by treating the cause. So treatment of cause can be the non-surgical measure. Examples like adequate control of the diabetes mellitus, removal of the cataractogenous drugs, or removal of irradiations. The second one is measure to delay the progression. Like we can give vitamin E, aspirin in delaying the process. We can also use iodide salt of calcium and potassium. And the third measure is that we can improve the vision by arranging the illumination, by prescribing the glasses for refractive status, or use of dark goggles in patients with the central opacities. In surgical measures, we have two surgeries. The first one is intracapsular cataract extraction, that is ICCE, and the second one is ECCE, that is extracapsular cataract extraction. We are not using intracapsular cataract extraction nowadays. This question can be asked in your vivas or in your examinations. Nowadays, we are preferring the extracapsular cataract extraction. So, what are the types of extracapsular cataract extraction? So, the types of extracapsular cataract extractions are conventional ECCE, SICS means small incision cataract surgery, phacoemulsification, and the latest surgeries like the FLANCS means femtosecond laser assisted cataract surgery, in which we are using the ND glasses. So right over here, that is ND glasses. In all these surgeries, the most important surgery for your examination point of view is phacoemulsification. So before going to start with phacoemulsification, we must know about the differences between ICCE and ECCE. So first we have ICCE and the another one, that is ECCE. In ICCE, entire cataractous lens along with intact capsule is removed. That is, both lens and capsule is removed. In ECCE, lens nucleus and cortex removed, leaving the capsular bag behind. And in ICCE, we are removing whole lens with the capsular bag. Okay. Second point is, we are taking incision 10 to 12 millimeter in ICCE, while the incision is taken in ECCE is 7 to 8 millimeter. And note that the ECCE is a universal operation and can be performed in all ages except when jonules are not intact. Yes. Whereas the ICCE cannot be performed below the 40 year of age. Note this point. Now we are moving toward very important topic, that is phacoemulsification. Moving toward its operational procedures, we must know about the pre-operational procedures. So what are the steps of phacoemulsification is, first, that is pre-operational, in which we are giving topical anesthesia plus mydriatic or cycloplegic to the patient. Painting of betadine solution can be applied on the external ocular surface, plus we can instill the betadine in conjunctival sac or middle canthus. In operational procedures, the first procedure is the corneal incision required is very small, that is from 2.8 to 3 millimeter. That's why we can say that this is smallest incision and in which sutureless surgery is possible with self-healing scleral and corneal tunnel. After the incision, there is a continuous curvilinear capsular axis, and this is preferred over other methods of anterior capsulotomy. Next, we are doing hydrodissection, that is separation of the capsule from the cortex by injecting the fluid exactly between the two. Due to this, there is a separation of the cortex from the capsule, right? This process facilitates the nucleus rotation. After that, we are doing emulsification of the nucleus. In emulsification of the nucleus, look at this diagram. This is the titanium needle, which vibrates by piezoelectric crystal, and it's vibrate at ultrasonic speed, that is about 40,000 times per second, and that's why there is a emulsification of the lens. So here we have emulsified lens. Then what we will do? Yes, the next step is that aspiration of the remaining cortical lens matter, and this is done with the help of irrigation aspiration technique. The next step is IOL implantation. So we implant the intraocular lenses in our cataract surgeries. But do you ever think, how can we calculate the power of intraocular lenses with respect to the person that we are going to treat? For measurement of the IOL power, the first step is measure corneal curvature. Now, how can we measure the corneal curvature? Do you know which method? Yes, we can use by keratometry. The second method is measure axial length of the eye. How can we measure the axial length? We can measure it by the A-scan USG. So, the most commonly used formula for the calculation of the intraocular lenses is SRK2 formula, in which P stands for calculation of the intraocular power, A stands for a constant of intraocular lens, K stands for the power of cornea, and the L stands for the axial length of the eye. So P is equals to A minus 0.9K minus 2.5L. This is the formula for calculation of the power of intraocular lenses. We can also use the formulas like SRKT formula if the axial length is more than 26 mm and Hopfer Q formula if the axial length is less than 22 mm. So this is all about the management of cataracts in adult, and in this lecture we focused all the important point with this respect to topic. So do a quick revision. First we talk about the non-surgical measures. After that, in surgical measures we have two methods, that is ICC and ECC. Then we discuss about the types of ECC, that is conventional, SICS, phacoemulsification, and the latex surgery, that is the flanks. Then we talk about the differences between the ICC and ECC. After that, we discuss about the phacoemulsification, in which we are first going through the pre-operational procedures, and after that we discuss about the operative procedures, right? And then after the phacoemulsification, we discuss about how to calculate the power of intraocular lenses, in which we discuss about the SRK formula 2, which is most commonly used, and we can use the other formulas like SRKT and Hopper Q formula. So this is all about the management of cataract surgery. Now moving toward the complication of the cataract surgeries. This topic is favorite to the examiners and most commonly asked in your vivas. So be attentive. We are going to cover pre-operative complications. After that, we are going to cover operative complications, then early post-operative complications. After that, delayed post-operative complications, and at last we will going to discuss about IOL related complications. In this lecture we will going throughout all the complications, but we will focus only on those complications which is important for your PG preparation or which is important for your examination point of view. So first one is pre-operative complications, in which the first one is anxiety. It is occur due to the fear and apprehension of operation. So we can use the drugs like alprazolam or diazepam to alleviate such symptoms. The second one is irritative or allergic conjunctivitis. It may occur in some patient due to preoperative topical antibiotics drops. So it is occur due to topical antibiotics. Then the third one is nausea and gastritis. Why there is a problem like nausea and gastritis to the patient? Yes, it is due to preoperative medicines such as acetazolamide, and it can be due to the medicines like glycerol. Antacid can usually relieve the symptoms. Then there can be complications due to local anesthesia. So there may be the complications like retrobulbar hemorrhage or perforation of the globe. And at last, there can be corneal aberration. Why there is a corneal aberration? Due to use of tonometry. Okay, so how can we remember the preoperative complications? Yes, there is a simple mnemonic, that is INAC. What is INAC? INAC, it is the Hindi term, and the meaning of INAC is mirror. So this is about preoperative complications. So, A for anxiety, I for irritative or allergic conjunctivitis, N for nausea and gastritis, A for anesthesia, that is local anesthesia, and C for corneal aberration. So this is about preoperative complications. Okay, now we are going to discuss about operative complications. Operative complications are very easy to remember because we are going to relate it by steps of cataract surgery in step by steps. The first complication is superior rectus muscle laceration. Bridle suture is applied to hold the superior rectus muscle, and after that we are going to prepare for conjunctival flap. And during the preparation of the conjunctival flap, there might be excessive bleeding can occur. The second one is excessive bleeding. The third one is incision related complication. Incision can be irregular, or due to the incision related complications, there might be button holing of anterior wall of tunnel. Then there might be injury can be occur due to sharp tipped instruments such as keratome or a piece of razor blade. So there can be injury to the cornea, it can be to the iris or to the lens. In cornea, there may be desmoid detachment. In iris, it can cause iridodialysis. Then there is a complication which are related to anterior capsular excess, because first there is the anterior capsule. So there might be problem like escaping capsular excess, there might be small capsular excess, or there may be very large capsular excess, and which may be cause problems for the back placement of the intraocular lens. And remember that in eccentric capsular excess, which can lead to the problem for intraocular lens decentration at the later stages. So these are the problems due to anterior capsular excess. After the anterior capsule, there is a lens, and the complications which are related to the lens are nuclear drop in the vitreous cavity, or there can be posterior loss of lens fragments. After the lens, there is a posterior capsule, and there can be posterior capsular rupture. After the posterior capsule, there is a vitreous, and there may be vitreous loss. There can be zonular dehiscence, and at last there is a choroid. Look over here. Here we have the choroid, and there may be expulsive choroidal hemorrhage, or there can be suprachoroidal hemorrhage. So first complication is superior rectus muscle laceration while holding the bridle suture. Then there is excessive bleeding. There can be incision related complications. After that, there may be injury to the cornea, iris or the lens. Then there is anterior capsule, and there is complications which are related to the anterior capsular excess. Then there is nuclear drop into the vitreous cavity, or there can be posterior loss of the lens fragments. Then there is posterior capsule, and there can be posterior capsular rupture. After that, there is vitreous, and there may be vitreous loss. Then zonular dehiscence, and after that there can be expulsive choroidal hemorrhage, and at last there can be suprachoroidal hemorrhage. Now we have post-operative complications, and there can be early post-operative complications, or there might be late operative complications. So in early post-operative complications, there may be hyphema, that is collection of blood in anterior chamber. Then there can be iris prolapse. There might be striate keratopathy. There may be flat anterior chamber. There may be post-operative anterior uveitis, that is the inflammation of the uvea. Then there can be toxic anterior segment syndrome. And at last, there can be bacterial endophthalmitis, that is superative inflammation of the eyeball. So we can remember it as FETIS. F for flat anterior chamber, E for bacterial endophthalmitis, T for toxic anterior segment syndrome, I for iris prolapse, S for striate keratopathy, and H for hyphema. So in which bacterial endophthalmitis, it is important for your examination point of view. So what is bacterial endophthalmitis? It is a superative inflammation of the eyeball. Look at this diagram. There is a inflammation of the eyeball. So endophthalmitis can be occur in acute onset or it can be occur in chronic onset. That is, it can occur in early complications and it can be occur in the late complications. Late complications means about the 6 weeks. So early complications occur most commonly due to the staphylococcus epidermidis. Chronic complication is most commonly occur due to propionibacterium acnes. Clinical features are pain, redness of the eye, hypopyon, that is pus in anterior chamber, and there may be yellowish exudate in the vitreous. The treatment of endophthalmitis, it can be divided into two parts. That is, when the person is totally blind and there is a vision is present. So in blind person, we can do the evisceration. That is removal of everything in the eye excepting sclera. And when there is a vision is present, we can do the pars plana vitrectomy, plus we will give intravitreal antibiotics like vancomycin and ceftazidine, and after that we can give the topical antibiotics. So this is about endophthalmitis. And in late complications, there may be after cataract, or we can call it as secondary cataract. There may be pseudophakic bullous keratopathy, cystoid macular edema, there may be retinal detachment, endophthalmitis or epithelial ingrowth, and at last there may be complications like fibrous downgrowth. So how can we remember the late complications? Yes, it is very simple. That is A, B, C, D, E, F. Very simple mnemonic. A for after cataract, B for bullous keratopathy, that is pseudophakic bullous keratopathy, C for cystoid macular edema, D for detachment, that is retinal detachment, E for endophthalmitis and epithelial ingrowth, and F for fibrous downgrowth. So this is about early and late postoperative complications. And at last, we are going to discuss about intraocular lens related complications. So in which there may be malposition of the intraocular lens, there can be pupillary capture of the intraocular lens, or there might be toxic anterior segment syndrome. In malpositioning of the lens, there may be sunset syndrome or there can be sunrise syndrome. In sunset syndrome, look at this diagram. This is the lens and there is a inferior subluxation of the intraocular lens. Yes, we can easily locate this intraocular lens which is subluxed inferiorly. And in sunrise syndrome, there is a superior subluxation of the intraocular lens. Look at this diagram. There is a superior subluxation of the intraocular lens. And remember that UGH syndrome. What is UGH syndrome? U for uveitis, G for glaucoma, and H for hyphema. It is occur due to the rigid anterior chamber intraocular lens. It is occur due to rigid anterior chamber intraocular lens. And what is its treatment? The replacement of anterior chamber intraocular lens by posterior chamber intraocular lens. Remember this point because it is asked many times in the exams. The treatment is replacement of the anterior chamber IOL by posterior chamber IOL. Okay, so this is all about the complications of the cataract surgery. in which we first discuss about preoperative complications. After that, we discuss about operative complications. There is 12 points. And then we discuss about postoperative complications. There is early and late. And we have the simple mnemonic, that is PETIS and ABCDEF. Both have 7 points. After that, we discuss about IOL related complications, in which malpositioning of the intraocular lens, pupillary capture of the intraocular lens, and toxic anterior segment syndrome. In malposition, there is sunset syndrome, sunrise syndrome, and remember about UGS syndrome, U for uveitis, G for glaucoma, and H for hypema. And the treatment is replacement of anterior chamber IOL by posterior chamber IOL. So this is all about the complication of the cataract surgery. I know that you might be exhausted, but thanks for listening this one and upgrading your knowledge with medicos.